Good morning or good afternoon, everyone, depending on where you're logging in from today. In recognition of March National Essential Tremor Awareness Month, thank you for joining our webinar on understanding deep brain stimulation, also known as DBS therapy for essential tremor. My name is Debbie Lynn, and I am with Medtronic, and I am pleased to kick off our educational webinar today, which is being recorded. So we plan to cover a lot of useful information today, whether this is your first time hearing about DBS therapy for essential tremor, or if you've already been talking with your doctor and are planning to have DBS therapy. In today's webinar, we will provide an overview of essential tremor, and we'll discuss deep brain stimulation as a treatment option and how it can help. We will also review, we will also review recent innovations and advancements with the Medtronic deep brain stimulation system to deliver DBS therapy. And then we'll have some time at the end for Q&A. Okay. So with that, I am happy to introduce our clinician speaker today, Dr. Duarte Machado. Dr. Machado is a neurologist, a movement disorder specialist with Hartford Healthcare in Hartford, Connecticut. He is a director of the Chase Family Movement Disorders Center, where he manages a wide range of neurological conditions and has extensive clinical experience with deep brain stimulation therapy for the treatment of movement disorders, including essential tremor. We are very fortunate to have Dr. Machado sharing his clinical expertise with us today. And with that, I'll pass it on to Dr. Machado. Thank you, Dr. Machado.
All right, thank you so much. It's my pleasure to spend some time this morning or this afternoon to discuss this important topic with you all. And the information shared today is the opinion and experience of myself, and I'm a paid consultant for Medtronic as my disclosure. So let me begin with an overview of essential tremor. So essential tremor is actually the most common tremor disorder and really the most common movement disorder. It's 8 times more common than Parkinson's disease. So it affects about 10 million Americans and millions more worldwide. And it is a progressive neurological condition. So that's important to note, that this is progressive. It's considered neurodegenerative as well. And it's characterized by a postural and or kinetic tremor. So postural, when a person is holding their hand out as when holding a newspaper, for example, or kinetic, as when handwriting. And it most often affects the hands or arms, although other body areas like the head and neck and voice can be affected. And it's a slowly progressive condition, which means that, you know, patients may spend years before they seek treatment because they may say, well, this is due to normal part of aging. But in fact, tremor is never a normal part of aging. So that's important to keep in mind, that if a tremor is noted, then that should be evaluated by a healthcare professional. And the beneficial effect of alcohol is seen about 60% of the time. And that's due to the fact that essential tremor involves an inhibitory neurochemical called GABA. So GABA is a neurotransmitter, like other neurotransmitters that you may have heard of, like serotonin, dopamine. So GABA is inhibitory, and in essential tremor, there's a loss of that inhibitory function, and too much overactivity occurs that is transmitted out to the limbs, and thus tremor occurs. And since alcohol binds to the GABA receptor, that's why alcohol can suppress tremor, because it increases the amount of GABA, that inhibitory neurochemical. So certainly we see some patients who early on may try to suppress tremor with alcohol, but certainly it's best to seek the healthcare professional to get other treatments in play. Now, age and family history are the two greatest factors for essential tremor. Now, with regards to age, we see people across the whole spectrum have essential tremor from developing in childhood to late in age. But the most common age of onset is about 40 years and older, and the incidence increases with each decade thereafter. So essential tremor can affect up to 6 to 9% of people over the age of 60. So that's a large portion of the population. And many people have a family history of tremor. So 50% plus on average of patients with essential tremor have another relative with essential tremor. So that's always a question I ask my patients. Is there someone else in the family that also has a similar tremor? And while a few genes have been associated with ET, genetic testing is not currently available. There hasn't been a single type of specific gene that's been implicated definitively with essential tremor. And that's why we can't specifically test for genes that are associated with essential tremor. So the diagnosis without a biomarker, if you will, or lab test is really made clinically by your doctor. There's also no radiographic scan, so there's nothing on imaging of the brain that would distinguish and determine that someone in fact has essential tremor. But certainly there's clinical criteria that I'll review shortly that is what we use to make a diagnosis of essential tremor. And that's why it's important to seek out the assessment of essential tremor, because it is treatable. So I've certainly seen patients who think that, you know, this is a tremor that they have just grown accustomed to living with and have made changes in their routine due to the tremor, but that doesn't have to be the case. Essential tremor is treatable. And also it's important to seek medical attention because essential tremor may be confused with Parkinson's or some other form of tremor, and the treatments are very different. So to avoid misdiagnosis and to assume that, that there's not an adequate treatment is something that should be avoided. Instead, seek the counsel of a healthcare professional for proper diagnosis and proper treatment plan. So with regards to treatment, we know that there's several medications that are used for essential tremor. They help reduce tremor about 50% of the time. And so that for some people provide only partial control of tremor, which is why it's great that we have other options besides medications to treat tremor. And certainly we'll review DBS in detail today. So let me start with showing a video of a patient with fairly significant tremor in doing a task that we have our patients do in the clinic called an Archimedes spiral task, where they're asked to place the tip of a pen on a dot in the middle of a spiral and then go in between the lines until they reach the end, another dot at the end of that. And we ask them not to touch the page with their hand, but really just the tip of the pen. So that looks at both postural tremor when they hold the pen suspended in the ear, and then the kinetic tremor as you move the pen through the spiral. And watch how difficult it is for this particular patient to do that.
Get the pen down there is the hard part.
Yeah.
So that's common.
I can't rest my hand.
Huh? Right.
Well, good luck.
This is the tip of the pen.
Okay. It's not going to do it.
Okay. Go ahead, try resting your hand and see if you can do it.
If I just let it calm down.
Okay.
Yeah, so keep this video in your mind, because we're going to come back to this patient later on and we're going to see how the same person does after having DBS with regards to his ability to complete this task with much greater ease. So in terms of the diagnosis, there are elements to that we use. One is that we look for a bilateral or a tremor on both sides. It's postural or action or both of the hands and forearms, and not solely a rest tremor. If we see a solely a rest tremor, then we think, could this be a Parkinsonism, and also not just an isolated head tremor. With for example, with dystonia, if we see anything like dystonia, which is an abnormal muscle contracture causing posturing with a head tremor, then that could be cervical dystonia, not essential tremor. The absence of other neurological signs. So we want to make sure there's no significant muscle stiffness or rigidity that again would be seen in someone with a Parkinsonism. And then secondary criteria include long duration disease. So as mentioned earlier, because this is a slowly progressive condition, patients may take a couple of years to come to clinical attention. So we ask, well, how long has a person had tremor? The family history is important, as I mentioned. And then if a person does drink alcohol, we ask, well, what's the response when you do drink alcohol? Since essential tremor oftentimes is suppressed to some degree with alcohol. And then for some further ways to distinguish essential tremor from Parkinson's disease include on clinical exam, the frequency of tremor. So a Parkinson's tremor is a slower frequency tremor. The handwriting is different. As you just saw, when trying to do a task with pen and paper, it's people with essential tremor may have large rhythmic strokes. And in Parkinson's, it's called micrographic, very small, decreased handwriting. So even when I see the intake forms of patients who are seeing me for initial consultation, just assessing their handwriting is often a big clue, actually, even before I walk in the room as to what the diagnosis may be. Now, what causes essential tremor? We actually don't exactly know what the cause is. So certainly there's a genetic component, but there may also be some environmental cause that can trigger essential tremor, but we're not entirely sure what all of those factors are. But we know that there is evidence that links it to dysfunction of parts of the brain, including the brainstem or the cerebellum. And I mentioned essential tremor, maybe genetic and running families, and a large number of those cases are inherited. And studies of the genetics of essential tremor are ongoing. So hopefully in the years to come, we'll have more information about the genetics of essential tremor. Now, aside from medications, which I mentioned can help reduce tremor upwards of 50%, other modalities of treating tremor non-pharmacologically include working with other members of a care team. These may include a physical therapist because the essential tremor affects the cerebellum, as mentioned, and the cerebellum is really critical for coordination and balance. So it's not uncommon for someone with essential tremor to have an unsteady gait. The issues with coordination affecting the hands can often be helped with an occupational therapist. So referral to that type of individual is often helpful. For those who have voice tremor, a speech therapist may also be helpful to that individual. And then there's also data to indicate that there may be cognitive impairment in essential tremor as well. In particular, with issues with executive functioning, verbal fluency, abstraction, working memory, efficiency of memory recall, and sometimes visual spatial function as well. And so if there is some cognitive concern, then working with a neuropsychologist to get more detailed information about cognitive strengths and weaknesses in order to improve upon any weaknesses is often helpful as well. So it really takes a team approach. So being part of a program, a healthcare program that gives you access to other team members is often very helpful. And not only that, it's not just what happens in the clinical area, but recognize that there is a wide network of support for patients with essential tremor, because essential tremor has significant impacts on other quality of life measures, you know, going out to a restaurant, that the type of social embarrassment that may occur, and being able to talk to other people with essential tremor about coping strategies and being in a network of others who understand what you may have experienced yourself is important. So the International Essential Tremor Foundation is a worldwide organization for those with essential tremor, And this organization has local support groups. So the one that I'm medical director for proudly is the Connecticut East Central Tremor Support Group, and the website's listed there. So we're a very robust group, meeting every other month, the first Saturday of the month. So our next meeting is actually this coming Saturday. And it's a wonderful way to connect with others to discuss, you know, common challenges, but also common solutions. So now, in looking at the treatment paradigm of essential tremor, we look at, you know, the most commonly used medications and the most effective oral medications, propranolol and primidone. We start with one, and then potentially the other, and then potentially a combination of both. And when there's still insufficient benefit, then thinking about deep brain stimulation is certainly very appropriate, because we know that that to get better tremor control, one needs to think beyond medications alone. So the indication for DBS for essential tremor is shown here. So deep brain stimulation delivers electrical stimulation to an area of the brain to help treat essential tremor. This stimulation is delivered to one side of the body only, and it's used to treat tremor in one arm of the body. So typically, we choose the dominant side or the side that's most effective. But generally speaking, because the essential tremor tends to be quite symmetric, patients opt to choose their dominant limb to receive DBS. And a person may be a candidate for this therapy if they have essential tremor, again, not adequately controlled by medications, and that the tremor is disabling. So it's important to note that the safety and effectiveness of this therapy has not been established for bilateral stimulation of both sides. So it's used for one side only, or for patients over the age of 80. And we're going to discuss some inclusion type of criteria for those who are good candidates for this. So let's go into more detail about DBS for essential tremor. So it's important to recognize that this has been around for some time, FDA approved in 1997, but I hope you'll appreciate over the course of the rest of this program how much DBS has evolved over time, how much more exquisite and elegant of a technology it is to help patients and really customize a treatment approach. So with DBS, it's one lead is implanted to deliver electrical stimulation to a part of the brain called the thalamus, and in a particular part of the thalamus called the VIM, the ventral intermediate nucleus of the thalamus. This electrical current delivered through the lead is believed to then disrupt and modulate the abnormal motor circuit activity, which then smooths out motor symptom control. So I mentioned earlier that there's excessive activity from the brain due to loss of that inhibition. So there's too much excitation. So this abnormal electrical activity being produced by the cells then goes out to the limb and causes tremor. So if you, in a simplistic way to think about this, if you then deliver another current, if you will, to then dampen down that abnormal excessive activity, you're sort of restoring and smoothing out the normal brain function by helping to restore that normal activity. And we know this works. So over 175,000 patients worldwide have now received Medtronic DBS therapy across all indications. So with deep brain stimulation, the studies have shown significantly reduces tremor, improves disability, and improves activities of daily living, and is reversible. So it's not a lesional issue. So there are other treatments for essential tremor which are cause a lesion in the brain, and this is does not do that. So it's reversible. So now let's go back to the patient that we met earlier, and let's see how he does with the DBS stimulation that's turned on. So you'll see up above, it's to the left VIM. So to the left part of the brain to control the right hand. So now let's see how well he does.
OK. Good, and try and draw a straight line. And now you can go ahead and set your hand on the paper like you normally would. Print ABC.
You can see how readable that is. It's
quite... And then write the numbers 1, 2, 3.
Write the numbers?
Yeah, just 1, 2, 3. Good. Now I'd like you to try drawing this spiral, but with your hand down, not just the tip of the pen. Excellent. Good job.
Yeah, so here we can certainly appreciate the pre and post effect. From DBS, that previously you saw how long it would take this person to even place the pen on the dot to even start the task. And then, never mind trying to do the task without touching the black line, trying to stay within the lines. And here he's able to do that with much greater ease of staying within the lines. And with DBS, with each programming session, I'll go into detail about what that looks like when I mention and talk about programming sessions. But after DBS, as we go along in the process of adjusting the device, I've seen where the results like this occur early. And then as we go through, a degree of tremor suppression is greater still, whereby a patient can over time potentially do this with great ease. So the results, vary patient to patient, but this is something that I tell patients that with DBS, we can suppress tremor to some degree. It's just a matter of over time to what degree, but certainly a substantial amount. And with each programming session, it's about making progress, not perfection. And it's great that session by session, we continue to make progress as we go through the journey of having someone undergo those programming sessions with me. So who's a good candidate for deep brain stimulation? Someone with a clear diagnosis of essential tremor. So fitting that clinical criteria, as I mentioned, those with intact cognitive function. So what that refers to is all patients undergo a neuropsychological testing to get a baseline cognitive function. If there's concern about a major neurocognitive disorder, then as a team that is discussed whether that person is appropriate for deep brain stimulation, because we need to take into account their overall health. And that gets to the next point of lack of comorbidity. And that refers to ensuring that there's not some other significant medical issue like significant heart disease or uncontrolled diabetes that would interfere with the surgical procedure. Patients are good candidates if medications haven't worked or have caused intolerable side effects, as we discussed. Patients less than age 80, because we don't have data about safety in those older than 80. A clear screening MRI of the brain to ensure that there's nothing structurally interfering with the trajectory of the lead as it goes into the thalamus in the brain. Degree of disability. Again, those with very mild essential tremor that can be controlled with medication, then that should be done first, for example. And then willingness and ability to be seen for follow-up visits. So this is a journey that patients start along with the doctor and the healthcare team, the neurosurgeons and the whole team. It's important that we help patients along in this process and that they're partners in this process with us. So the components of the deep brain stimulation are shown here. There's an implanted lead on one side of the brain that delivers electrical pulses to the area of the brain affecting movement, in this case, the thalamus. An extension to connect the lead to the battery. So that goes along the scalp behind the ear and then down to the chest. And in the chest is the neurostimulator. It's the implantable pulse generator, IPG. That's a neurostimulator or battery that powers the system. And so all that's implanted. And then there's a clinician programmer, and the patient has their own patient controller that communicates with this implantable pulse generator. And it's used to turn the device on and off, adjust the delivery, change settings to account for a particular activity that the person might be doing. So there's a lot of flexibility with these controllers, and I'll share that shortly as well. So how is the lead placed? It's done carefully by the surgical team using MRI or CT scan to capture the images of the brain and then calculate it in 3D precisely what the best trajectory to reach the target is. So here in the schematic is shown a picture of the thalamus, and then a portion of that shown in dark green is the VIM portion of the thalamus. And then the neurostimulator is coursing through that. And it's you can see the different contact points where electrical current is going to emanate from this. So those are labeled 0 to 3 along the electrode. And using sophisticated software and instruments, a neurosurgeon can really precisely guide this electrode lead precisely to target, and that's going to be critical. So a well-placed lead will then allow someone like myself, a neurologist, to then turn the device on and program quite effectively. So the process is typically of this nature, and this is how my institution does it, but certainly the process may vary institution to institution. So speak with your healthcare provider to understand the process at your own institution. But as an example, the lead placement, where the lead is placed into the brain, is followed by one night inpatient stay. And then about 2 weeks later, patients will return for placement of the extension and battery placement. And that's an outpatient same day surgery. Patients go home same day. And then about 2 to 4 weeks later, they'll see the neurologist for initial programming. So why we wait these 2 to 4 weeks to allow time for healing prior to activating the therapy generally. Now, there's certainly, as I mentioned, been a lot of innovation and excitement in the field. And this is just the very start of it. And I'll discuss more as we go along. But there is Percept PC neurostimulator. So this is smaller by about 20% and thinner by about 20% compared to the previous model. And this is important because it's a less noticeable profile when it goes underneath the skin and the chest wall, especially for very thin patients where having a thinner profile device won't be as noticeable. It has a smooth edges for comfort. It's also designed to facilitate expanded capabilities with software upgrades. So you'll have the hardware implanted, but when software upgrades come out, this type of technology can be upgraded without having to remove the device and the hardware, if you will, and place a new one. And then there's also enhanced longevity tools to help you and your doctor monitor your battery life. So that comes with the patient programmer to see, okay, how much battery life is on the device and keeping track of that quite nicely. Now with programming, patients come in and after that 2 to 4 week period, after that second phase where the IPG is implanted in the chest wall, they'll come in to turn the device on for the first time. And an improvement of symptoms may be immediate. I mean, it's just incredible to see results. And for patients who have had tremor for years and years, for them to say, they just feel the sense of calmness, that not to to experience the tremor. I mean, it's really an enlightening experience and one that enriches my own work as a clinician when they see that happen in front of me. And then the program is customized. So there's so many different settings that we can use to determine the optimal stimulation parameters while minimizing side effects. So the fine tuning occurs over a series of appointments. And you know, we have a specific criteria for what we call optimization. So when is a person with DBS optimized and getting to the point where they're satisfied with tremor control and we don't need to make other adjustments. Now, in terms of safety and risks, as with any surgical procedure, there are risks with DBS, and these may include, but are not limited to, surgical risk, device-related complications, such as infection, for example, at the site of the implantable pulse generator, for example. If that happens, then that would need to be assessed by the neurosurgery team. Neurological or psychiatric symptoms. For some neurological symptoms, that those may be something we can adjust the programming to try to minimize as a side effect. So if someone is having numbness or tingling as a side effect, then potentially there could be a change to their programming to minimize that. And with other symptoms, we have the data from the neuropsychological assessment at baseline to understand, okay, what's this person's baseline? So that if symptoms were to change, then we can closely follow those symptoms. And then interference with other medical devices, what this refers to is patients may have, for example, a cardiac pacemaker in their body. It's not to say that they cannot have DBS at all. Certainly patients can have a battery on either side of the chest, and the neurosurgeon would be mindful looking at the distance between the two so that there wouldn't be any interference, but that's important to note. And so these types of safety and potential risks would be discussed between you and your doctor. So now let's go through in more a bit more detail about the innovations for essential tremor for Medtronic DBS. So I talked about the Percept. It's a battery, it's smaller, delivers controlled electrical stimulation, similar to a cardiac pacemaker. So pacemaker for control of excessive activity from the brain. There's the DBS programmer and communicator. So it's a mobile device, and this allows you to monitor your stimulation settings and control when therapy is on and off. So the therapy can easily be turned on and off. You can check battery status, make adjustments to the stimulator. And then there's also the introduction of sense site directional leads. So no longer is the stimulation in a circular fashion around the lead, but now can be directed in one direction or another, depending on where the potential for greater degree of symptom control occurs in the brain. So the leads are now segmented to allow for specific parts of the brain to be more or less stimulated. So I'm going into more detail with that. In May 2021, the FDA approved the SenSight directional lead system. It allows for directional stimulation when and where it's needed to help optimize stimulation, minimize side effect. This device, it's really incredible that the number of different programming options that allows for customization. And this is a new era of medicine. Like, how do we customize, personalize a person's therapy? We know that no two people with essential tremor are the same. And how do we achieve optimal outcomes for each individual patient? So having this device now gets us closer to that goal. And what's more, there's also brain sense technology. So this is another innovation from Medtronic. It offers it's the first to do this, the first DBS system to combine the benefits of directional stimulation and sensing capabilities. So what that refers to is that the electrode not only stimulates, but also senses the activity that's occurring in the brain. So it can pick up specific brain signals, translate them back to the battery, and then we can actually check the battery and look at a snapshot of brainwave activity And not only that, it could be done in a way that gives a sense of how the activity changes with certain events, meaning on your handheld device, you can type in certain events that you may be doing throughout the day that essential tremor may be interfering with, such as what's listed on this example here on the phone, playing guitar, brushing teeth, writing. If you're doing those tasks and you can press the event button on your handheld device and while you're doing that task, and that will put a place marker so that when we're going back and looking at your day-to-day activity from the brain, we can see, you know, how does the brainwave activity change when you're doing that particular task, and how is the therapy from DBS working to during that period of time. It allows us to make further changes and further fine-tune and customize the stimulation to really make the person have the most trauma reduction over the greatest period of time. So living with DBS allows a person to really continue doing the things they love to do, including travel. So that's a common question I get. Medtronic will provide a device identification card so that you are able to travel. You absolutely can get an MRI. With regards to the Medtronic Percept PC, has the first DBS system with 3T MR conditional capabilities. So that's in play, again, with the 3T MR conditional capability. The ability to check the device, as mentioned, is available. So you can easily engage and conveniently engage with the DBS programmer because patients will receive this handheld programmer, which is fairly discreet to use. And so changes can be made fairly readily and easily. And then being able to resume activities fairly soon after having the device done, and then being able to do more activities if your tremor is well controlled than before. So really great flexibility with regards to having this device. And so in summary, the take-home messages are to recognize that there's this advanced DBS system with sensing capabilities available now to allow for personalized care, delivering directional stimulation and sensing capabilities to allow for completely tailored type of stimulation. It has smart technology, this brain sense technology, to continuously capture and record brain signals at different activities that you happen to be doing during the day to help then clinicians to optimize your stimulation. The enhanced comfort based on the battery design. And then also trusted outcomes. So Medtronic has been an innovator in the field the longest, has long-term data for proven outcomes and patient experience. So at this time, you know, ask yourself, when is the right time for Medtronic DBS? So if you have essential tremor, in the spirit of March being National Essential Tremor Month, think about if you'd be eligible for DBS. And certainly if you're on medications, they haven't worked, they've caused intolerable side effects, and the tremor is disabling you and keeping you from doing what you want to do, you know, think about Medtronic DBS, because this therapy may certainly be right for you. And at this time, I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Dara.
Hello, hello. Thank you so much, Dr. Machado. That was a great presentation, a great overview, and very thorough and very clear. We've gotten a lot of positive comments from the participants, so thank you so much. Before we get into Q&A, the one thing I just want to make sure that we cover is that, you know, you as patients should always discuss risks and benefits of any procedure with your clinician, including deep brain stimulation surgery. So that is very important that you do. Your healthcare professional is your expert, and they are aware of all of the things about you that they need to take into consideration. So that is key. So we are going to move into the Q&A section. And as a reminder, with the Q&A, it's either at the top, the bottom, the side. It is located on your screen. So please, please, please continue to ask questions. I do have a few that came in. And I will also highlight a couple that I think are key. So Dr. Machado, I want to start out with one that I think is a really great question. What brought you to deep brain stimulation? What brought you to this therapy? What brought you to offer patients this therapy in your practice?
Yeah, so that goes back to my training. So I went into movement disorders when my grandmother had developed a movement disorder. And then, you know, at the time, thinking about what types of therapies would be most helpful to her. Unfortunately, she passed away when I was a medical student, but once I went into residency, you know, my focus was, you know, what I want to incorporate the best therapies, those that have the potential to deliver the best types of outcomes to my patients. And as a resident, being able to see for the first time the potential of DBS to suppress symptoms like nothing else I've ever seen before was really outstanding and was eye-opening. The first couple of patients, you know, they come into the clinic, they bring family members, they'd be eagerly anticipating the device to turn on. And once it did, and we saw results right before our very eyes, there were tears shed, there were hugs given, and it was just something so rewarding that I can't even explain it. Like, it's that feeling that you get of saying, you know, I've really contributed to increasing this person's quality of life in a way that I would only dream of being able to do is really why in my career, I said, this is definitely something that I need to tell patients about to make sure that they're aware of the potential options for controlling their symptoms.
I love seeing the way your smile just lit up. and it's amazing because I ask this question a lot to clinicians and their answers are very similar. So thank you for sharing that. So a couple questions that came in from the audience, you know, you talked about, you showed that slide about essential tremor and Parkinsonian tremor. You know, can a patient have both of these things in your experience? Have you seen that?
Yes. Yep. So there is data that indicates that patients with essential tremor are at a higher risk to develop Parkinson's. And that's generally the trajectory, that it's people have essential tremor for a period of time and then may develop Parkinson's later. So then they have Parkinson's with antecedent ET. And there's still a lot of work being done to try to identify who's at risk for that happening.
So I guess the next question I have is, you've been doing this for a while, right? And so you've had the joy of seeing the treatments evolve. What are the things that you feel are most unique and innovative, especially when thinking about, you know, Percept and Medtronic devices?
Yeah, in my opinion, it's been the sense-side, the ability to look at the innate brain signals and use those to help guide treatments.
So the other question we got is that now we've heard about a treatment procedure called focus ultrasound. You spoke a little bit about lesioning.
Yeah, so the focus ultrasound is a lesioning effect. What that means is that when you get ultrasound, there's over 1,000 ultrasound beams that focus in and cause a thermal effect or a lesion in the thalamus. And that's irreversible. So once that occurs, it cannot be undone. And similarly, And the effect you get is sort of the effect you get from that procedure. So if tremor suppression occurs to some degree, but then over time it gets worse because we know essential tremor is progressive, then that initial lesion will not have, you can't adjust it. There's no adjusting of the effect that you get. Similarly, those who have side effect like trouble with balance or ataxia, which is the most common side effect of focused ultrasound, or numbness with deep brain stimulation, the therapy is adjustable over time. And that's really critical. Being able to make adjustments, however fine they are. I mean, when I see patients in clinic, like I saw two patients with essential tremor yesterday. One of them I did no adjustment. With the other, it's, you know, by a point one in the current upwards to for a very fine tremor that was seen. Now this is a year and a half after she had it done. So being able to just make various fine adjustments and continue over time to have robust tremor suppression. And it's also important to realize that with focused ultrasound, it's not an easy procedure in the fact that patients have to have their hair shaved off because it's a thermal lesioning procedure. So the head is shaved. It takes several hours to do. It also is done by neurosurgery. So really, keep those factors in mind. So at least for my patients, I'll always prefer Medtronic DBS over other surgical treatments for essential tremor.
Thank you for sharing that. And, you know, also the piece around the personalization also is quite different in terms of looking at local field potentials. Mm-hmm. Great question. And this is actually tied into the last question. Does the benefits of deep brain stimulation for tremor, in your experience, wear off over time in your clinical experience?
In my experience, I tell patients we have thousands of different combinations with the Medtronic DBS system to continue to make adjustments over time to help suppress tremor. So that ability as an anti-tremor technology persists over time. As I mentioned, people with essential tremor can develop other symptoms, such as worsening coordination, clumsiness, balance problems. And that certainly is related to having essential tremor, but that's not what the Medtronic DBS does. So it's important not to confuse, what is the goal of the DBS treatment to suppress tremor versus other symptoms that can get worse over time. So having that in mind, we know that in my experience, that the robustness of anti-tremor effect with Medtronic DBS does persist over time, over years. And there's data to support that too.
Yes. Definitely speaking to your doctor and hearing their personal experience is very valuable there. We got a question about saving stimulation. Do you sometimes give patients the ability to turn their stimulation off at night, which is a little bit different than maybe some other DBS indications?
Yes, that's a good point. So all of my patients using a handheld device, they all have the flexibility to adjust their DBS up and down, to change within different groups depending on the activity they're doing. And also, I'll counsel them that if they feel comfortable in turning it off at night, then they may do so. It's patient to patient. So I have one patient who says, my tremor is significant enough that even trying to reach over and turn on a light on and off at night is challenging. So I keep mine on, and that's perfectly fine. But for those who do feel comfortable turning it off at night to preserve the battery life, that's an option. Yeah.
Great. One other question that I wanted to ask you, MRI. So you brought that up as one of the final things in your slide. I know that sometimes patients get very anxious if they have to turn their stimulation off. Anything related to Medtronic DBS with essential tremor that you've been able to take advantage of for those patients?
Yeah. So on the device, so no longer is it like an on-off complete. There is an MRI mode, if you will, that you can select with your handheld programmer that your physician will program on your device. So it'll allow you to have the MRI done even with the device on. So if you're having a significant tremor and you're concerned about motion in the MRI, when the battery's off, then they can be kept on within a specific parameter that your physician will program on your device and that you can then select prior to the MRI.
Great. So sometimes with certain settings, they're able to remain on while they're getting their MRI, which is a definite uniqueness to Medtronic, which I feel like patients really like.
Yes.
Perfect. Well, guess what? I think that we are at time and the questions were great. So thank you, audience, for asking great questions. Dr. Machado, I just want to thank you again. Amazingly informative talk. And thank you so much for this conversation we just had. For those of you on the call that want to learn more, there is a QR code that is on the screen. You can always visit www.medtronic.com/DBS and learn more about this therapy in essential tremor. So thanks again. I hope everybody has a good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are in the world. And thank you again for attending.
Thanks.
All right. Bye-bye.